You're listening to the Final Draft Insider View, a podcast where we talk to writers about all the words, phrases, and sentences and all the other stuff in between that they write. I'm your host, Pete D'Alessandro, product manager here at Final Draft. Today, our guest is a former winner of our Big Break contest back in 2014 when he won the sci-fi category. Welcome, Joe Greenberg.
Pete, how you doing? It's great to be here. Thank you very much for having me.
Thanks for being on the show. Joe, let's talk a little bit about kind of what your background was and getting into writing, just so we have some background on how you came to where you are today.
Okay. I was one of those people that always wrote, even as a kid. And, you know, that sort of led to kind of pursuing, I don't know, I guess I should say, you know, I'm one of those people that's kind of always been a writer. I'd never remember a time in my life, even sort of going back to when I was very young in school, when I wasn't writing something, even if it was, we're supposed to be paying attention in math class. And I was, you know, using that little lined paper for our arithmetic to write stories like in the margins. And I don't know. And I was also somebody that was always fascinated with filmmaking. You know, I when I was 12 years old, I found our 8mm home movie camera that had belonged to my grandfather, and it had half a roll of film in it. And I made, you know, sort of a, you know, like a silent slasher film with some kids from the neighborhood. And then, you know, my grandfather then gave me a VHS camcorder, and that evolved into running around in the woods with my friends trying to sort of make movies and things like that. And but always there was, you know, there was writing, and everything kind of came from the writing of it. And I remember when I was, you know, even making these ridiculous things with my friends, it was always kind of like a chore to talk them into coming back in the woods to do, you know, what they regarded as something that was kind of stupid or uncool, you know, just how you think of things when you're a kid. So I would write dialogue specifically for them that sounded the way that they spoke. That was the things that they said. And, you know, my hope was that if it sounded like them, they were more apt to kind of come back and kind of play along with me. And I don't know, I have been told that I have a very good, you know, ear for dialogue. And I think that's where that evolved from. So, wow. Yeah, that's an odd way, I guess, to kind of come about that sort of skill. But so, yeah, it was always writing for me, you know, writing short stories. And then, you know, kind of I kind of became and I kind of come from a movie family. We always were going out to the movies every week as a family. And, you know, even New Year's Day, we would, you know, we had these holidays that we would always kind of pick a family movie to go to. And, you know, I came of age in the advent of the video store, and we would always go, and we would get three or four movies, and each of us got to pick a movie. And so as much as we would watch TV, we would watch an equal amount of movies, which now with Netflix and all these streaming services, that doesn't sound too far out of the realm of really what everybody does. But, you know, when I was a kid and the video store was a new thing, that wasn't the norm, you know, to be a movie household as opposed to just, you know, a family that sat and watched TV or TV shows and things like that. So I don't know, that kind of transitioned into going to college for filmmaking. I went to Rowan University in South Jersey, and I was a radio TV film major because that was as specified, as close to film as, you know, just pure film as you could get. And I took every writing class that I could there. And since then, you know, since kind of going out, I later went back to Rowan for my master's degree. I got a master's degree in creative writing in 2008 from them. But I was always just writing specs. I had ideas and I would write them. You know, like when I was a sophomore in high school, I got Sid Field's Screenwriter's Workbook. My aunt got it for me. Wow. And I wrote my first feature-length script in the back of my sophomore chemistry class. You know, I don't really have a mind, I guess, for, you know, math or sciences. And really that class was for me just about melting pennies on a Bunsen burner. And then I just had this notebook that I started writing scenes with once I got this book. And, you know, before I knew it, I had a 120-page zombie script, which, you know, I would shudder to kind of look back on it now as far as craft goes. But that was my first spec. And I just remember feeling, you know, not like, oh, like I felt like it was a real accomplishment to have gotten through that book and gotten through that script and said, this is, you know, I know that this is rough, but I've completed this. I can do this. And since that point, I've always been, you know, kind of writing. So, you know, that is what led me to kind of think about it as, trying to pursue it as a profession, and you know, it's obviously very difficult to kind of break in. So there was this kind of trying to figure out what my day job was going to be in the meantime. And you know, I wound up working for NFL Films, where I've been for, you know, this is my 17th football season with them.
Wow.
Yeah, and what attracted me to them was not necessarily, I mean, I guess I like football as much as, you know, the next red-blooded American guy, but what attracted me to working there was it's the biggest post-production facility on the East Coast. Mm-hmm. And the access to that equipment, and they have a good culture there in that if you're working on a personal project, I mean, as long as it's not something like, you know, you couldn't really sneak a feature in under the radar, but if you were doing a short or something like that, or you know, I did, you know, I kind of was in a sketch comedy group for a while where we you know, did produce sketches and things. Wow. Like that, yeah, you could use their facilities as long as there was nothing booked on like the machines or, you know, in the department, you could use their gear, because to them it made you a happier employee, but you were also trying different things and you kind of became better at your craft, like what. Sure. We were all there. So I did get a lot of support, you know, from them, you know, in that regard. And but during all this time, I would kind of come home and I would always be writing. And you know, right up until big break happened, I think I was, you know, with two jobs, I was averaging about two specs a year that just kind of went into a drawer.
Wow.
And I would submit these things to different contests, you know, like Big Break, like Nickel, and, you know, really, I equated applying to these contests as, you know, the way that you apply to colleges. You have your reach schools, which are, you know, going to be like your Final Draft, Big Break, and your Nickel, and then, you know, you have your middle of the road ones, which are, you know, I don't want to insult anybody by saying they're a middle of the road contest, but then on the bottom is your safety school, which would be like the, you know, the Duluth Horror Film Festival, you know, it takes place in, you know, the middle of March, or, you know, something like that. But I would just submit to these contests, and I would not get past the first round, and I would get the feedback, and I would redraft, and then I would send it out to another contest. And I would just keep kind of doing that, and I kept it like a spreadsheet of where I had sent what to and what feedback I had gotten. And I just used that to kind of redraft again and again and again, and kind of continually be polishing. But also kind of keep creating new things, keep sending new things out, and starting that same process again with new material. And I noticed that my placement in these contests started creeping up and up. I got to, you know, like past the first round, and then, you know, I got to like, hey, top 10% or semifinals. And, you know, I remember when I knew that I had made it to the finals of Big Break, and I was waiting for, you know, they told me around, okay, this is when we're going to do our notifications. And I was expecting an email just to say, oh, yeah, you know, congratulations on making a finalist. And, you know, you kind of get that boilerplate rejection email of like, there was a lot of great material this year. but, you know, it never came. And it was like 2, 3, 4, almost, you know, like probably 5 days after when I was told, you know, like, okay, this is when we're going to make decisions. And, you know, I got a call from a California phone number, which at that time, you know, had. The only call I was getting from California was my friend that works at a bar in Culver City. and it was Shelley Malott calling to tell me that I had, you know, won in the sci-fi category that year. And that basically, you know, and she kind of went over everything, and I don't want to say it took me by surprise, because that wasn't really the feel. It was more like shock. Like, I don't think I really ever expected, after having done this for so long and really trying to kind of get to that point where, you know, you're a feature winner, which I think is technically what the category winners are called in Final Draft, as opposed to like the grand prize winner. Mm-hmm, right. I wasn't expecting someone to call me and tell me that I'd won. That for some reason, like, completely blindsided me. So, and you know, at the time, and Man Alive, which is, you know, kind of the script, I guess, that we're going to be talking about.
Sure, yeah.
I thought that was going to be it. I was like, wow, it's $1,000 for winning a, you know, like the feature prize, and I'm going to be able to buy a new water heater with that. That was my big, so excited.
Wow.
You know, and it never occurred to me, you know, like the grand prize was, you know, it's obviously more, and I did not even think of that. It was just, I thought this was going to be really cool. I was going to go out to the awards. My buddy was going to let me crash on his couch. He was going to be my plus one. We were going to go kind of have a cool night, and then that would be it. And, you know, as I'm sure we're going to kind of get to, the script kind of took off after that.
Yeah, well, let's get right into that. Let's go there. So where did the script go? What happened after you made this, you showed up to this contest and you collect your trophy, and I imagine there's a check involved, but what happens next?
Yeah, I went out there, visited my buddy. We did a bunch of cool stuff. We went to the awards, which were, you know, on the Paramount lot, and I took lots of pictures, and I came home, and I remember thinking, like, okay, well, that was really great. Now, you know, I was still back in the mode of like, okay, what's my next thing that's going to go out? And then I noticed I started getting a lot of emails from like management companies, and it was all junior guys, like really people who, you know, were trying to make a name for themselves wherever they were working. And, you know, they were looking at these contests and trying to be the person that scooped up whatever, you know, the interesting or the contest winner was of all of these contests. So I got a lot of calls. I went back and forth with a lot of people. There was a lot of three email exchanges that then kind of petered out or didn't really go anywhere. And then that went for, yeah, I want to say almost 6 months, but it was sort of, I would get like three or four emails and maybe even a couple phone calls a week. And it was everything from, I would get like a page long email of, this is the company I'm with. This is what I want to do. This is what we're all about. We want you to be here, blah, 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 blah. It would be from a really detailed email to somebody that was like, congrats on the win. Love to read the script. Like, not wow. Signed. Not, yeah. Like, you know, and I don't know. I mean, it's all copyrighted. It's registered, you know, so you're kind of thinking like, you know, it's not like somebody can kind of just steal this from me, but at the same time, it's sort of weird. Like, what kind of sales pitch is that? Like,
right,
are you
right.
A rep? Like, you're not even telling me who you are. So it was a whole range of that. And then, there was one, you know, younger guy that worked at a management company in particular, who contacted me and said, I really like this. I've shown this draft to, you know, like a higher up in my company, like basically his boss. And she had said, I really like this. This would be a good kind of thing for you to be, this be sort of the first project that you take point on. Go over it with, you know, Joe, see if he's interested and see if you can do a pass. And when you think it's ready, kind of bring it back to my attention.
Okay. Was this so a management company or production company?
This was a management company.
Okay. All
right. So he and I went through really two drafts, and I believe and you know, we got it to like a really great place. He had very insightful notes, and it wasn't anything like, oh, you should change this or this doesn't work. The notes were more like, I see what you're trying to do here, and if you did A and B, it might bring it out like a little bit more, or you could get to the point a little bit more concisely. Like, there were really, you know, every single note that he gave me was really spot on. So we came out of that with a really, really great draft. And, you know, long story short, he just could not get it kind of beyond his boss. And he even said to me, he was like, look, and this, I want to say, takes us to just about a year ago, because this was through work last year. I went to the Super Bowl. I was working the Super Bowl, and this was right before I left. So this is probably, you know, mid-January. So he, you know, he finally said to me, he was like, look, I kind of can't get this. I can't really get them to take notice of this. And I just don't think it's going to go any further here. But I do have a friend who is over at, you know, at the time they were called Bender Spink. Now they're Good Fear Film and Management. Mm-hmm. You know, my very good friend over there is a guy named Scott Stoops. I would like to send this to him, if you don't mind. And, you know, maybe hopefully he can kind of, you know, take this a little bit further. And I said, sure, you know, because, you know, what the hell do I have to lose?
Right.
I'm sitting here in South Jersey at my day job. I'm like, yeah, you know, sure. If it's that or nothing, I would rather, you know, kind of give that a shot. So I had a couple calls with Scott Stoops, and then he really, really liked it, and he liked the draft that this other guy and I had kind of come up with. And he said, I'd love to show it to, you know, my bosses, who are, you know, Jake Weiner and Jake Wagner. And they really liked it. They got on the phone with me, and we had sort of like a getting to know you conversation. And they said, look, we really think this is kind of like a great piece of writing. We have a couple notes. Would you kind of be willing to hear them? But to be honest with you, we think that we could take this thing out, which, you know, in the parlance means start shopping it around. So I said, sure. And they had some notes, but again, they weren't really anything, you know, structurally or anything like that. They were really just like polished notes.
Wow.
And I just did a quick pass with them in less than a week. Like I talked to them on a Monday and I handed in the polished pass on Friday so that they would have it for the weekend. And that Monday is when they took it out. And I want to say it was probably 2 or 3 days later, I was contacted by Verve. And they, you know, I spoke with Brian Besser and Parker Davis over there. And long story short with them, I wound up signing with them as an agency. And then, you know, for lack of a better term, I guess the team was assembled at that point. So yeah. Now Verve and, you know, what would be Good Fear took it out. And I want to say it went to like 46 different companies, in, you know, and that was probably March-ish is when they first took it out. I want to say March of 2015 and then – or 2016, excuse me. Mm-hmm. And then I went out there in April and they said, we have a lot of people that want to meet you. Some of them, they want to meet you because they're interested in Man Alive. They're interested in producing. Others, Man Alive's not quite for them, but they like – there's something in the writing where they want to meet you. They want to have a general meeting with you. So I went out there. I did 25 meetings in 5 days.
Wow.
Which, yeah, was and, you know, to their credit, to, you know, the guys at Verve and Good Fear, they did a really good job of scheduling, like, one day is all in Beverly Hills, one day is, like, up in Burbank, and, you know, what you, so, but the hardest part of it was, you know, these meetings are, you know, they're nice and they're cordial, but you're kind of saying the same thing over and over again. And it's all like a getting to know you sort of thing. And you're okay. Well, where did the idea come from? And you kind of tell that. And, but as something would get bumped or whatever, it would get shifted to Friday. So maybe like one meeting a day, like didn't like fell through or whatever. So it would all get shifted to Friday. Mm-hmm. So even though like Monday through Thursday, you know, geographically was all focused in one spot, like Friday was completely schizophrenic. It was all over, you know, all over LA to like the, you know, everywhere from Burbank down to like Santa Monica. Ooh. and just, yeah, everywhere in between. And not only that, but it rained. And as I'm riding around, I'm thinking, there's like, how could this traffic be any worse? And then, you know, in the grand irony, it rained and I saw, you know, the one thing that makes LA traffic worse.
Yes.
Yeah. So there was, and it was actually the last meeting of the day on Friday where I'd met with this company and I was sitting down and we had this meeting and I was talking to the woman that was running the meeting. And it was really good. I had a great vibe from it. And they by far had the most in-depth take on the script. And I, wow, was thinking like, I'm really, yeah, kind of feeling like a connection with them. So we were talking about where the script came from. And as I'm in the middle of a sentence, I had this horrible feeling. And I was saying to myself, oh my God, I just said this like a minute ago. Like I'm repeating myself like a psychotic. So I stopped in mid-sentence and I said, I'm sorry, this may sound really crazy, but did I just say that? Like, did I just say this a minute ago? And she kind of smiled. She's like, no, you didn't, but you do look like you're at the end of a really, really long week. So we kind of had a laugh about that, but the meeting went very, very well. And then, you know, that weekend I went home and, you know, I was, you know, just kind of back here and I went back to normal life. And over the next couple weeks, like my guys followed up with everybody that I met with and, you know, I want to say that second week after I got home is when they said, okay, we have a couple offers here. They're really all for like an option. And we're sort of figuring out what the best place to go, like who's got the best plan to make this movie and what the best deal would be, you know, just kind of, you know, be available to hop on the phone because we're going to need to talk to you. I'm like, fine. You know, that's sure. This sounds like how this should go. So we were going back and forth with this company that I had a great connection with and were really, really great. And we thought that's where that Man Alive was going to land. And then out of nowhere, we got a call from somebody at Fox that just said, hey, we're calling about Man Alive. We just want to see if the property is still available. And at that point we hadn't gone, you know, really past the first, you know, or second round of kind of negotiations. So they said, yes, it's not, you know, it hasn't been sold yet. So they said, all right, we are going to call at 6 p.m. and you know, we're going to make an offer and you've got 3 hours to negotiate to kind of close the deal. And after that, the deal is, you know, it's going to go away. Like basically there's a brief window to kind of get this thing done, which I can completely understand. Like, sure, they don't, you know, when like a major player comes in, they don't want you trying to start a bidding war or whatever. Like they want to make a good deal.
Right.
So, you know, my guys, you know, I got the phone call from, you know, my agent, saying, okay, hey, this is what's going on. And, you know, I just remember I was standing there in a t-shirt and boxer shorts feeding my 2-year-old mac and cheese, and I have like the phone, like kind of like in the crick of my neck. And I'm like, what's happening? And they explain the whole thing. And I'm like, okay, what do you need me to do? And they're like, nothing. Don't do anything. You know, just kind of be ready to hop on the phone. So I was like, all right. So, you know, the night goes on. My wife and I are, you know, we wind up like binge watching 30 Rock, something like that. You know, we're just kind of just sitting there waiting for the phone to ring. And, you know, they call me up, and they had told me in that first call, you know, they said, you know, do you know Noah Hawley? And I said, you know, from Fargo, like the guy who had developed Fargo and really made this, because my wife and I are huge fans of Fargo. And they were like, yeah, he is interested in this as potentially like a feature directorial debut for him.
Wow.
And yeah, so I was just, and that's one of those things somebody tells you and you just, when you first hear it, you just don't believe. Right. You know, like you're like, yeah, sure. Yeah. Okay.
A guy whose work you already like, happens to be interested. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I just said, you know, okay, I'm just going to hang out. You know, I'm going to go back to 30 Rock and I'll just wait for the call. And so then they called back and they said, okay, you know, we've kind of gotten the offer from Fox. We're kind of preparing our counter. But, you know, Noah would like to speak with you. Is it okay if we give him your number? Which, you know, to me kind of felt like high school when, you know, you're going through an intermediary and there's a girl that you like. And, you know, like, I don't know. It's just this weird kind of dynamic. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, yeah, sure. So then this happens to be Twilight Zone style. The one time in the 10 years that I've lived in my house that I can't get a cell signal for, it just sort of vanished. So the phone rings and it's Noah Hawley calling, and I'm behind my house in the baseball field sitting on like these aluminum bleachers, like in the pitch black night.
Wow.
And I'll never forget, like I picked up the phone and was like, hi, and he introduced himself and he's like, so how's your night going? And I was like, it's going really cool. I'm just kind of waiting to see what's sort of happening here. And he just kind of started talking to me about Man Alive and, you know, sort of about this process and sort of what I thought about the script. And it was a good conversation that, you know, it lasted, it was probably 20 minutes to a half an hour, I want to say. And, you know, I said to him, I was like, well, look, you know, I know this, that as the writer, this is my script, but as the director, this is going to be your movie. So, like, just tell me, like, how do you see this coming together? Like, what's your vision for it? And he just started laying out this story of really, like, his approach to it. And it really gave me goosebumps to, you know, to be completely honest with you, to just hear, like, first of all, he's a brilliant, brilliant guy. He's very low key. He's very soft spoken. But the stuff that he says is like, Jesus, like this guy is really like tuned into something. So he had this really, really fantastic take on it. And, you know, all of the major like points of the story were just dead on what I intended as, you know, as the writer, which is, you know, it's the dream. That's what you know, you're going to have to hand this off. And this is the person that you want to hand it off to.
Yeah.
So, you know, and he said, okay, this is kind of written as like it's a $6 or $7 million movie on the page. Fox is probably going to want something closer to a $30 million thing. I don't want to change your story or your characters. I want to take what you've written and basically just put it in a bigger box. So that's where the rewrite will be. And I said, hey, that's fantastic. Like that's exactly, you know, what you're hoping to hear as the writer. And I said, I love your take on it. And I said, to be honest with you, if it's all the same to you, I'm totally okay with hopping off the phone, let the guys do their thing, and then you and I can get to work. And he said, I feel the same way. So, you know, it was probably about 2 hours later. Well, immediately, you know, I get off the phone, I call my agent, and they say, how did it go? And, you know, I kind of just went over the whole story. And they said, okay, we're going to lock this thing down. It sounds like you guys had a really good call. And they did. It was probably about midnight on the East Coast when they kind of called and told me that the deal was locked in. And, you know, the deal was for, you know, the purchase. And they also said that, you know, Noah kind of wants to bring you along for the rewrite, which I was very glad to hear because, you know, when you're having a conversation like this for the first time, you know, it feels really good, but you really don't know. Like, you don't know if the other person on the other end is kind of having that same sort of feeling, you know, and especially, you know, just in this business, like it can kind of be that way. You can think you're doing well, but you talk to your agent, they're like, what did you say? But it wasn't like that at all. They said, you know, Noah kind of wants to bring you along for, you know, like a rewrite. So that's what the deal is. It's the purchase price and the rewrite. So I worked with his producing partner, Lee Cate. Lee Cate and John Cameron were the, you know, the other two people, 26 Keys, who were, you know, kind of involved in the development of this. And, you know, I want to say as we were going through the outline of what the rewrite was going to look like, Lee Cate was my day-to-day person. She was the person that I worked with most closely. Mm-hmm. And it was really, really great. Everything, you know, she would kind of come in with a note and say, okay, we really feel like this, you know, he needs to be a little bit more proactive earlier in act one, or, you know, act two, you know, we're thinking about like the, you know, the sort of the set piece that's the focus of that. We kind of think should go in this direction. So just play with that and see what you can come up with. And for the most part, everything that I came up with, they were like, wow, that's great. We love it. Like there was never a time when I, you know, felt rebuffed or, you know, like I,
wow.
It was a very collaborative process. And I really felt like I was treated very, very well by them. But, you know, like I love Lee Cate. It was a great partnership. So we had kind of fleshed out roughly what the rewrite was going to look like. And then I went back out, I want to say it was probably early August of last year, 2016. And then that was when, you know, I went into 26 Keys, met with them earlier in the week. We made sure everybody was on the same page. And then we went into Fox to pitch our idea for the rewrite to Matt Riley over there. And he was very receptive. It was a very good meeting. And he kind of cut us loose to do our thing. And, you know, I kind of continued working with Lee. And I turned the rewrite in just before Thanksgiving last year. I think, yeah, it was in November. So
really just a few months ago.
Yeah. Had it in just before the holidays. And, you know, as everything's kind of moving along and just sort of waiting to hear sort really what's coming next. And I don't know. I think it's in a really good place, and I've gotten just a lot of good feedback on the rewrite and everything like that. So I'm feeling pretty good at this point.
That's awesome. So, I mean, this is still your active project, and I know you're working on other stuff. We'll get to that in a minute, but let's backtrack a second and talk about some of the stuff. I mean, you're coming to Hollywood for the first time to pitch your movie around town. You're talking to everybody. I mean, I'm curious of what that 25 meetings in 1 week, what went through your mind there, and how did your pitch wind up changing from beginning to end of that? Did you learn doing, and did that influence what you were doing?
Yeah, I definitely, yes, you know, and when you kind of do the, you know, the water bottle tour, which is what they call that, when you kind of do your inaugural run through all of this, mm-hmm. you know, by the end of the week, you kind of have it down, and it's very easy to, when I first got out there, my first meeting was with, you know, the guys over at Good Fear, and I had no idea, I just could not grasp the concept of a general meeting. They're like, well, they want to meet you and talk to you. And I'm like, about what? Like, they're not, like, Man Alive is not for them. I didn't get that. Like, why would they want to talk to me? And they were saying, well, down the line, they might have something for you. But that still wasn't, you know, registering in my mind.
Right.
But then I realized, like, okay, and this was kind of going to the different meetings. Like, the general meetings are, like, we do these kinds of projects, and your voice seems to fit in with really, you know, our ethos over here. And you know, your voice kind of is something like we like the kinds of stories that you tell. So we just, you know, kind of want to meet you to sort of see where, you know, the space that you're most comfortable in. And when something like this comes in, or even knowing that you're out there and having met you, if something comes in, you know, if we think it's a good fit for you, like that could be something that we're going to work on together. Now the people that were most interested in Man Alive, there was a lot less getting to know you, and it was more right down to business. Like they, okay, hey, how you doing? It's really great. We love the script. Could you tell us a little bit about it? And it's like, okay, this is our plan to get Man Alive made. This is our plan to get this be done. Yeah, so they were tonally two very different kinds of meetings. I don't know. I was nervous kind of going in, but and again, this is sort of something that you know, was kind of, I'm one of those people that I could go into like a big meeting and I don't really realize like the gravity of it until I'm walking out of the room afterwards. And then that's when I have like this huge letdown of like, oh my God. And then I'm going over like every little thing that I said. And I'm like, well, you know, should I have been more, you know, this or that? Or, so I think, you know, through no through no fortitude of my own, that may have helped, because I just had this very relaxed presentation of everything. But it was definitely doing that hell week. And I say hell week in the schedule, that everybody that I met with was, I think there was only one meeting that was, you know, probably I walked out of there and I'm like, I can't, like, it was almost hostile. Like I couldn't, you know, and it was just, and I've come to since learn that this was just this one producer's personality. Mm-hmm. But I remember thinking like I walked in and I sat down and okay, this is a good, I guess, example or answer to your question of kind of being nervous or these types of meetings. I sat down in his office and we sit there and he's like, yeah, so, you know, I read Man Alive and, you know, like the hook is pretty good in the beginning, but then, you know, it just wasn't for me. Dead silence. And he's like staring at me and I'm like, look at him like, okay. And then, you know, this kind of, as somebody that did sketch comedy and we did live performances, I thought like, okay, this is me on stage. Like one of these times we bombed, like you can't just walk off the stage. You have to try and win the room back. So I start talking to him about, okay, well, what are his interests and what does he do? And he was talking about these adaptations and we wound up talking about like Stephen King and, you know, things maybe I read from Stephen King that I'd never seen adapted, which I thought could be, you know, good fodder versus stuff that had been done, you know, maybe not so well before. And we wound up having a great conversation about that. And I forget what I said, but I did something that made him laugh, like a genuine, like, oh, okay. You know, so we had like a split second of connection in the entire like hour and a half long meeting. So I walked out of there thinking that was a win, that I got that guy to smile. That was the only one that I would say is like a tough, I was, you know, kind of nervous really throughout the whole thing that, you know, it just didn't feel like it was going well. But everybody else, you know, I don't know, everybody, it was nice. It was a good vibe going through there. Everybody knew the deal. Everybody knew that I was kind of being dragged all over town and everybody was very, you know, kind of empathetic. So it was a lot of great meetings and I don't know, it was fun kind of going out doing that once. I don't know if I would be as positive about the experience if, you know, I had to kind of sit through it again, but I learned a lot about, you know, you kind of go to school and you learn the craft of screenwriting and then you get out and you're writing on your own and you know, just, you know, you kind of do workshopping and you kind of learn other things by getting feedback from people that aren't classmates or professors and, you know, people that are brutally honest with you. Like there's something to be said for that. Like you need to hear that stuff. And then you also know about production. You know, okay, when I'm on a film set, like I could stand there with a DP and we could talk about something and we can talk back. We can have a conversation about what lens to shoot it with. And I can have that conversation and do that. But the thing that I had not really conceived of and something that I don't think is really taught in school is how many different ways there are to get a movie made. And that's what, you know, the meetings that I had where people were telling me their plan to make the movie, I didn't realize there were so many different combinations and you're basically looking for a balance of who's got the best combination and the highest probability of being able to lock the money in to kind of get this thing done.
Wow.
So it was interesting to kind of see that and I learned, you know, and I up to this point have been an adjunct professor. I teach, you know, at Rowan University. I went back and was an adjunct. I taught screenwriting and advanced film production.
Wow.
So kind of having that knowledge of everything, it was almost like a whole other dimension that I really knew was out there, but I didn't realize that this is the critical moment is these meetings in like, this is really where the deal gets. This is how the movie gets made is picking the right combination, picking the right company to kind of help you bring it to the screen. And that was a new experience for me. That was something I hadn't expected to even be exposed to. And it was really cool. It was a learning experience all around.
Right. That's a question I would never have thought to ask. Like which one of these is going to move me the most forward, or at least most likely to move me forward?
Yeah.
That's fascinating. Right. That's an interesting way to interesting thing to learn from that. All right, so let's keep going. So at this point, you know, are you working on other stuff?
Yeah, we're I've been actively pitching, you know, it's funny because there were things that were kind of coming in, like when I went out there and first started having these meetings, we would get like one or two like open writing assignments that came in, and then once this sale was announced, it was like overnight, like that. The sale was like it was midnight here when the deal was done on a Thursday night into Friday morning, and then I think like a blurb popped up on like the IMDb news page on Friday, and then that following week it was like bombarded. So-and-so sent this in for your consideration. Take a look at this. If there's da-da-da-da-da. This is something that they just secured the rights to. Like, it was all this, you know, there's all this IP. And, like, what about this for a real? Like, it really just seemed like that stuff kind of, it was like a wave. So right away, you were kind of thrown right into it. And, you know, you learn basically drafting, like, you know, okay, I'm talking to this, I'm talking to this guy about this adaptation, and we're having this conversation, and I'm taking notes, and some people that you are pitching an assignment to, they want to see a pitch doc. Others don't. They want to have a conversation with you, and some people will only talk to you on Skype because they want to be able to see you, and, you know, you just kind of, you're thrown into the fire, and it's all this, you know, kind of high-octane stuff, and, you know, you get to this point where it's like, okay, it's down to you and somebody else, and that somebody else has a couple other credits, and you have one sale, so they decided to go with him, even though your idea was really great and they liked it. So there's been a lot of that, but then it's also, you know, I want to say at the same time, trying to work and figure out with my guys what my next spec is going to be. Mm-hmm. I've got like a slew of different ideas, and we're really trying to figure out, I guess, what the best follow-up to Man Alive is going to be at this point, because I do have like a whole wide range of stuff from, you know, elevated sci-fi and you know, genre and you know, horror and stuff like that. That's kind of the space where I'm very comfortable with, but I've also done, I have a couple specs that are sort of in the psychological thriller sort of range, and I don't know, it's just really interesting kind of having a lot of ideas and talking to people about what, you know, what the best of all of your good ideas are. Like, it's in a lot of ways, that's an affirming conversation to have and debate to have. And in a lot of other ways, it's kind of nerve wracking. And, you know, I don't know, they're all your babies. You think they're all great. And I had two specs that I was about to start when, you know, this whole thing, this ride of Man Alive kind of came, and they both been kind of on pause. And one, I sort of keep kind of going back to, but, you know, we're hoping that really in the next couple of weeks we're going to lock in on, you know, whatever the strongest of my ideas is, kind of at this point and just sort of run with it. But,
that's great.
That's where I'm at right now.
So were they, I mean, they're going to contribute from the side of like, well, you know, since you have Man Alive and it looks like this kind of movie, then this is probably a better spec because it shows X, Y, and Z, and Man Alive didn't show those things, but it feels the same. Is that the kind of stuff they're bringing to the table at that point?
It's been more, the conversation has been more, okay, you just had this really big elevated sci-fi piece that came out. So this is the script that broke you through. So you may have a horror script or a romantic comedy script, which I don't have. But, you know, you may have all these different ideas, but just kind of you want to have a good follow-up that is sort of in, you know, not a similar kind of film, but in a similar sort of voice. So right now the three ideas that we kind of have it narrowed down to are all elevated sci-fi. And, you know, the idea really is to kind of get some momentum going and then kind of be able to branch out into some different things. So the conversation was never Man Alive was good at showcasing this as far as your writing ability. Let's do, you know, this, because, you know, this would be big budget world creation, so let's try that. Like, that's never been part of the equation in talking to the guys at Verve and Good Fear. So it's more been kind of this organic thing of kind of batting ideas back and forth, and even stuff they'll you know, kind of shoot me like a magazine article or something like that, just saying, hey, does this kind of stir anything up? This is sort of, I was reading this and thought that, you know, this might be something that you know, an idea that you could take and run with. So it's been like, that's kind of the, I guess, the nurturing environment that I'm getting from the guys at this point. But it's all been, you know, just tell us what you think, just give us some ideas. And they're, it's kind of a hands-off approach, which I like.
That's great.
Now at the same time, I'm one of those people, like, I have to be writing something at all times or I start to kind of like freak out. My wife will tell you, you know, she can tell if it's been a couple days since I've you know, written anything because I kind of get like punchy. But yeah, no, it's been really great with those guys. Like I think I have a really good team, which a lot of people, you know, kind of recognized even before I even knew what a team was. Like when I was going to these meetings, they were like, oh, you're over at, you know, Verve and, you know, Good Fear. That's a really good team. Like how did you land those guys? Like that was a question that I got from at least half of the people. Like, how did you, you know, Verve is like, they kind of have an exclusive clientele. Like, how did you get over there? And I would tell the story, and that was usually the icebreaker in those cases. So I really feel like I'm in good hands, and that is,
that's huge.
Somebody asked me like, yeah, you know, do you have any advice after you kind of break through? And, you know, like, what would you say? And I was like, well, you know, you have to trust, you know, what your team is kind of telling you, you know, like you're following your voice and there's things that you want to do, but they are looking at it like their job not only is to sell your stuff, but also to kind of protect your career and not really necessarily protect it, but kind of help you along and get you started on your path. And especially in the first few steps, like I have no idea, you know, about, you know, like I might have this great idea and they could say, okay, well, there's four studio movies and one indie that's coming out next year that are all pretty much the same thing. So that doesn't mean that my idea was bad. It just means that this isn't really the right timing for it. So then they'll say, okay, and then we'll kind of move on to the next thing. And that's sort of what that's the best guidance that they kind of give you. And you have to trust that they, you know, kind of know what they're talking about. And I've been, you know, I would like to say blessed with a pretty good team. So I'm happy in their hands, and we're trying to figure out, I guess, what the next couple moves are going to be. But it's all, I feel really good about where I'm at right now.
That's fantastic. So let's go back to the writing a little bit, and maybe we'll wrap this up here. But to me, you obviously worked really hard. You wrote script after script and submitted. I mean, how many times do you think you submitted to contests? Do you have any idea?
If I had my little spreadsheet in front of me, I could tell you. But I would say, when Man Alive sold, I had 11 spec scripts in the drawer.
Wow.
And I want to say I probably submitted total submissions, and this is for those 11 scripts, at least 25 or 30 submissions. That's over great. The course, yeah, like 5 or 6 years, I would say.
So yeah, there was definitely some, I mean, the law of averages to some extent. You play the game enough times. But obviously your writing was good. Otherwise it would not have gotten anyone excited. It would not have won contests. So in the craft, I mean, what have you learned as a writer over, you know, 11 scripts and through the rewrites and through the people you work in? What's the big takeaway for writers out there?
Get to the point. Yeah. Like be as concise as possible, you know, like, you know, and a lot of it is, and it's really interesting because I noticed that when I went back to graduate school for creative writing, like it was just really, it was prose. Like there was not a screen program at all, but I learned so much about like the higher level of the craft of writing at that point. And it really is. And this is something that, you know, when talking to people about Men Alive that they responded to, they said, this is really clean writing. Like you kind of get to the point and you're not interjecting things, and you know it can be something simple as like, don't write anything that doesn't have like a direct visual corollary, but really, you know, you're you know, oh, he's looking out the window thinking about his love lost, and like, no, he looks out the window thinking, like, it really right. is, you know, you got to think, screenwriting is it's not this long flowing prose, it's, you got to think Hemingway, it's really just matter of fact, because really if you think about it, it's a document that it's meant to be read by professionals. It's not a novel that's going to be for like a wide audience. You're writing to a very specific audience and you need to communicate to them your visuals and what the action is as quickly and as cleanly as possible. And that makes it easier to read. And, you know, if you look at a page of screenwriting and it's just these like blocks and blocks and blocks of descriptive text, like it's arduous, like you can't get through that script. So, I don't know. I would say, just be as concise as possible. And really, if you're looking at a page, and this really, the first thing that I do when I go back and I'm kind of thumbing through and I'm getting ready to redraft or do another pass, I will look at the descriptive action. And if there's huge blocks of text, I will look at it and say, okay, this is five sentences. How can I say the same thing in three sentences or two sentences? And that needs to be the approach that, you know, you need to, you know, Stephen King had this great line in his book on writing where he said, you have to kill your darlings. I think he said, you know, repeated it three times. And you really need to kind of do that. You really have to get it down to the bare bones of what that action is. And when it comes to dialogue, you know, it's that, it's kind of the old adage, like, if you want to write good dialogue, listen to how people talk, you know, don't, you know, front load exposition in your dialogue, you know, like those, it really is the standard things that you hear over and over again, show, don't tell. And, you know, you just kind of have to, you need to be able to write it, burn through that first draft, and then go back and say, okay, now I need to read this like I'm reading it for the first time. What are the things that are going to jump out at me? Like, you need to learn to read your stuff the way that another person will. And once you can do that, and it's not easy when you first start, once you can do that, then you're like, okay, no, what was I thinking here? Like, you start, you know, really just drawing lines all over the script, and it's almost like heart-wrenching or gut-wrenching to kind of do that. But then when you go back and you just give it that polish, like, it's so much cleaner. So I don't know, I guess to kind of boil that down, you know, in the interest of being concise myself, I would say, get to the point. That's the biggest piece of advice I could give.
That's great. Well, let's bring it to a close there. Can you tell us where we can find your work, what we can see?
I have a number of short films, like I said, are on Vimeo. You can just search Joseph J. Greenberg. Other than that, that's it. I probably have, I want to say, five or six shorts that you can see. I'm in pre-production of another one that we actually just lost our location yesterday. So that's kind of a...
Sorry to have interrupted that. Yeah.
Well, you know, it's... I feel a lot better about that today. because, you know, when I said we were pushing our dates, everybody was really, you know, because it happens. And this is sort of like indie film here and, you know, on the East Coast. So that's... I guess that's where I'm at right now. It's I'm feeling really good where I'm at script wise, and we're hoping to be able to kind of get this thing moving and then eventually down the road make the transition into directing as well, and hopefully, you know, my guys have come up with a good strategy to kind of get me on that path, and we'll see what we can do. Most, you know, I would say if you really were interested in kind of hearing more about what I'm up to, I'm part of a horror podcast called The Mobile Horror Companion. We're on iTunes. You can find us. We're also on Twitter. We're at MobileHC666, and on Facebook, just The Mobile Horror Companion. It's me and a reporter named Eugene Driscoll and a special makeup effects artist named Brian Spears, who's done some really, really great work. Like, movies that he's done have been, you know, they had something that went to Cannes. They've had a lot of things in Sundance, and he's him and his partner Pete Gerner, two guys that are really about to break out. So it's wow. Really good conversations about filmmaking, and it's not just, you know, about horror movies. It's kind of a horror centric podcast about films and filmmaking. So it's pretty cool. Tune in and check us out.
That's awesome. All right, well, Joseph Greenberg, thank you so much for joining us.
Pete, thank you for having me.
And if you are listening to this podcast out there, let us know if you like it by leaving a rating or review wherever you grab your podcast, iTunes or whatever it is you use. And until next time, happy writing.